Assalamu alaikum.
My name is Muhammad Yasser. I'm from Syria, Damascus. We'd like to ask Sheikh Mohammed Hussein, what is the Russian interest in the Middle East and especially in Syria? And what about Qatar and Saudi Arabia? Are they supporting the Zionism? And Sheikh Mohammed, you said once the Syrian people should take advantage of the Iran support for the Syrian regime and stop fighting. Well, I would like to say something. I just came 9 or 6 months ago from Syria. The Iran is sending soldiers to Syria to fight with the regime because Iran has the Shia government. And when they are killing my people, they are saying Ya Ali and they kill. So is it civil war or for supporting the regime or what? Thank you.
Okay, the first question was, what's Russia's role in the Middle East right now?
What is Russia's role in the continuing Arab Spring, which is now in Syria? Had it not been for Russia, Syria would today have already become another Libya. If you are comfortable with Libya, if you are happy with NATO's control of Libya, then I don't want to see your face. I don't want to hear your voice. No. I can't consider you to be a Muslim brother when Allah has spoken so clearly in the Quran. You should rather make tawbah and understand the folly of what was done in Libya and what is now being done in Syria. So we thank President Vladimir Putin for standing up and resisting them and defending Syria from becoming another Zionist state. The question pertains to Iran's support for President Bashar Assad and his regime. The strategy of the Zionists is to provoke civil war in Islam, Shia Sunni civil war. And I've mentioned the Salafis so many times in my talk because they are the drum beaters for Shia Sunni civil war, the foolish drum beaters for Shia Sunni civil war. If Shia Sunni civil war were to envelop the world of Islam today, the major beneficiary would be Israel. And we would look like fools to the rest of the world who sympathize with Islam.
Assalamu alaikum, my name is Saeed. I'm from Bangladesh. I live in New Zealand. First, it's an honor to be here because I read Dr. Muzaffar's articles on globalresearch.ca. Just to add to your point how extreme Salafi thinking is, last year the Salafis exploded car of the Mufti in Tatarstan, which is a republic in Russia, saying that they are not following the Sharia strictly enough. And just a question to Sheikh Imran. In this, all the prophecies that we know about the end times, it's bound to happen because they are prophecies by our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How chaotic is it going to get, and what is the Muslim preparation for those who are living in the West, like myself, who live in New Zealand? And thank you, Salam.
Assalamu
West, meaning the Zionist West. How should they prepare themselves for what is to come? I no longer travel to any country which is a member state of NATO. No, sir. So for me to travel from Malaysia back to my native island of Trinidad, I've got to take a route through Moscow now. I have advised those who are residents in the United States, in Canada, in Britain, in France, countries which are militantly supportive of Zionism, and who are Muslims or non-Muslims, but also opposing Zionism. Your first option is hijra, out of those countries. If you can get out and go to another part of the world, because Allah's earth is wide, another part of the world which is more hospitable for people who stand up to the Zionist rulers of the world, then please do so. But that's not possible for all. So the second option would be to get out of the cities of the modern Europe and America. Get out of the cities and relocate to the remote countryside in small communities. This is the message that comes out of which surah of the Quran? Suratul Kahf of the Quran. Suratul Kahf of the Quran. And the story, the young man and the king. Withdrawal for security.
Next question to Sheikh Brian as well. If we consider Russia as a power that never colonized any country, then how to explain its occupation of total territory of Central Asia, Finland, Volga region, Urals, Ukraine, Crimea, etc.?
Number one, we must make a distinction, if it is possible for us, between Russia before the Bolshevik Revolution, Tsarist Russia, and Russia under the Soviet Union. The Russia before the Bolshevik Revolution is now returning. So the sins of the Soviet Union should not be put at the door of Russia. Number two, my comments were clearly concerning those who fought wars of aggression to colonize the rest of the non-European world. To then exploit and bleed them the way Holland bled Indonesia for 350 years, sucking the blood of the people, so you can travel first class. And then to decolonize with deception, and the rest you heard about it. I said Russia never did that, and China never did that. Russia has never aspired to rule the world. China has never aspired to rule the world. But in the same way that there were wayward Muslims who fought wars of aggression, of which today we are ashamed, like the Ottoman Empire, so too there may have been instances in Russian history where they may have fought wars and occupied other territory, which were literal states, not around. But I don't think Russia ever reached to South Africa, did it? I never thought that Russia ever reached to South America, did it? This is the context in which I spoke.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Mirki Ibrahim, I'm from Kazakhstan. I want to ask a question from Sheikh Imran. There are two questions to ask. The one is, as we know that there is a commandment of Allah, the Almighty, saying that we must forbid the wrong and enjoin the right. But as you also said in the Surah Al-Maidah, that we should not enter into the lines of those which are the Judeo-Christian lines. But what happens in the case if injustice, there's an injustice within the region, and if the uprising is in the interest of the Judeo-Christian Alliance, what to do in this case? Number one. Number two is, you said in one of the lectures that Israel will try to deceive the Russia or Russian alliance to enter into the war, etc. Can you please elaborate on that, and what should be the proper response of the Russian? Thank you.
Brother, could you rephrase the first question just now?
Yes. The first question regarding the dilemma, which is, we must forbid the wrong and join the right, but also we cannot enter into the alliance of Judeo-Christian alliance. So, in the case of injustice taking place within the region, if the uprising, for instance, will lead, is in the interest of Judeo-Christian alliance, what to do? What for the people, for sitting in the presence of the Almighty? What is recommended for them to do? Number two is, which is, okay.
Question. How should Russia prepare? What should Russia do to prepare itself for what is to come? I like that question. On the eve of the First World War, the Zionists embraced Russia with a deceptive embrace. In 1907, Britain and France mysteriously reached out to Russia to embrace her in an alliance. Wow! And then they added sugar to the alliance by promising Russia, since the Ottoman Empire was now viewed as the sick man of Europe and about to collapse, then we offer you Constantinople. And Russia was delighted with that offer to get back Constantinople. And Britain and France taking the offer, putting it down in the treaty. But it was deception. At the same time that they were embracing Russia to the front door, they were preparing to stab Russia in the back through the back door. And so when the Russian troops were an arm's length from Constantinople in 1917, they then triggered off their plan, their false flag, like 9/11, the Bolshevik Revolution, which was planned by Russian Jews, financed by Wall Street, supported by the American regime and the British. And the first thing that the Bolsheviks did was to take Russia out of the war. And so the Russian troops could not advance to Constantinople. They planned the Bolshevik Revolution at that particular moment to deny Russia Constantinople. But that was not the only plan. The Bolshevik Revolution then went on in 1922 to create the Soviet Union. And as I said earlier, the Soviet Union came into being with a master plan. That plan included an economic theory which in many respects was very kind of American. The chief architect of the Bretton Woods Accord, for example, the American delegate White, was always in praise of the socialist economy. But the master plan was for the Soviet Union to do the dirty work of suppressing and subduing and seeking to destroy the Eastern branch of the Christian Church, Orthodox Christianity. And secondly, to facilitate the movement of all the European Jews of Eastern Europe and Russia to Israel. And so Russia today has to be very careful. Epistemology is that branch of knowledge which studies knowledge. And they, the Zionists, say that we see with only one eye. The knowledge comes only from external observation and experimentation and so on. But the Quran says that we see with two eyes, not one. The Quran has a different epistemology. The knowledge comes only externally, that's their epistemology. And our epistemology from the Quran is that knowledge comes from two sources. One is external, and the other is internal. And so Russia has to return to its mystic roots, its Christian roots, to develop once again that capacity for internal insight, to supplement external analysis, so that you're not deceived. A second example of more recent is, and we must make mention of it publicly, is the vote of the Security Council on Libya to establish a no-fly zone over Libya. And Russia and China, with commendable innocence, fell for the trap that this was for humanitarian purposes. And so they abstained from the resolution, which allowed the resolution to be carried. But they were deceived. And they afterwards complained about it, that they were deceived. And once the West, the Zionists, had that resolution, they then proceeded to bomb the daylights out of the Libyan armed forces. And so the Salafis were able to take over Libya with the help of their NATO Zionist friends. At this moment in time, the question is very important. Russia and China have to be extremely careful not to be deceived. Dajjal has a PhD in deception. And so they're going to come after you attempting to deceive you. You were deceived in 1907 or 1909 and deceived again before the First World War. You were deceived again in the Security Council resolution. Do not be deceived again. What could be the plan by which they may seek to deceive you? I don't know. I wish I knew. If you are persecuted and oppressed in any part of the world, including Syria, including Russia, in any part of the world, if you are persecuted and you are oppressed, first of all, ask your question. Is there a historical explanation for it? Did your ancestors ever fight wars of aggression against Russian Christians and Bulgarian Christians and Romanian Christians and Armenian Christians in the Ottoman Empire? And as a consequence, instilled hatred in the hearts of these people because of injustice committed against them. And they are now responding to injustice because this is how they feel. The second reason you should ask yourself why the oppression and injustice is, are you taking any help from the CIA? Has the CIA been fishing in Chechnya or Chechnya? Has the CIA been fishing in Syria? Have they been offering you money? Have they been offering you weapons? As soon as Russia gets to know that Washington is involved, they will have to respond as they did in Georgia. In Georgia, they responded and they taught the Georgians a lesson that they will never forget for 1,000 years. And we're very proud of the way they responded to Georgia 5 years ago, on the eve of the US elections. They taught the Georgians a lesson that they'll never forget for 1,000 years. Why? Because Israel was there, the CIA was there, arming and training them to beat Russia. So you have to understand, if you are oppressed and you lack the means to be able to liberate yourself from oppression, do not take help from the Zionist alliance and throw the Quran behind your back, because Allah has prohibited you from doing that. If there is nowhere else you can get help from, then what do? You do what your Prophet did. Allah's blessing be upon him. He made Hijrah.
Thank you. A few more questions before we end, I guess, but I have to finish these questions because they're quite pertinent. This is in regards to the Turkish concern of humanitarian aid. I think so this regards to Turkish aid to Syria and backed by a loving approach of Said Nursi's teaching. Is it a symbol of hegemony or domination, Sheikh Ibrahim?
Turkey's relationship with Syria at this time parallels Turkey's relationship with Libya. Turkey played an active role in sending weapons to Benghazi. Turkey played an active role in training those who were to engage in the insurrection, not a popular uprising, but a pre-planned armed insurrection. And Turkey's role in Syria is exactly the same as it was in Libya. So we should not allow humanitarian aid to be thrown as dust in our eyes and obscure the bigger picture, which is one in which Turkey is playing the Zionist game up to the hilt, and we are ashamed of the conduct of the Turkish government. Having said that, there are large numbers of Turkish Muslims who are also ashamed of the government. And if Turkey were to make the mistake, which I believe it is going to make soon, to attack Syria, I suggest to you that the result will be Turkish.
What do you think about the future of Algeria in this world order? Is this country going to be the future target of Syria?
Thank you for that question. I love Algeria. I see the Algerians smiling. I call Algeria Bilal al-Mujahideen. You don't know it, but there's an amazing similarity between Algeria and Haiti. Both of them resisted the Zionist slave masters. Haiti under a freed slave named Toussaint Louverture raised an army of slaves 200 years ago and defeated the French army and drove them out of Haiti, and then proclaimed the Free Black Republic of Haiti. And Simon Bolivar went to Haiti to get some security and to seek some help to liberate Latin America. The French and Western Europe and the Zionists never forgave Haiti. And from that day to this day, they've been stamping their foot on him. When he returned to Jean-Bertrand Aristide, a Roman Catholic priest, to liberate itself from that venomous embrace, breathe the air of freedom. They staged a coup d'etat, sending mercenaries to the palace to seize him and ship him off to Central African Republic. And so he responded by announcing the existence of a new Christian Trinity. They said it's no longer the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. It's now the Father, the Son, and the CIA. And the punishment of Haiti continues to this day. Algeria is similar to Haiti because your fathers and your grandfathers waged a courageous war against France and beat them until eventually France had to withdraw, but never to forgive, never to forgive. And so watch it. They're coming after you in Algeria. What happened in the south of Algeria at the oil complex appears to me to have been a first trial shot. They did not expect the Algerian armed forces to respond as rapidly, as forcefully, and as successfully as they did, and to stamp it out. But they're going to come after you again. I hope and pray that Algeria will be able to survive, and there will be many Algerian Mujahideen who will join the army that will conquer Constantinople.
Last question to Sheikh Ran. Comment on the current policies of the Muslim world, i.e. OIC, in regards to the role of Russia and China in changing the order.
It is a pity that Iran continues to remain a member of the OIC. It's a pity that Syria could not see what Syria now sees and has not withdrawn from the OIC, which is just an old boys' club controlled by Saudi Arabia and the Zionists. There was only one moment in the history of the OIC when there was hope. When the war of 1973 took place, there was a very rapid increase in the price of oil. And that was when the petrodollar eventually came to be. But Faisal Rahimahullah recognized an opportunity, and Zulfikar Ali Bhutto recognized an opportunity, and these two very intelligent men came together to organize the Lahore Islamic Summit Conference of February 1974, which shook the Zionists so much. It was an earthquake for them that Indira Gandhi had to respond 2 months later with the first Indian nuclear explosion. So India joined the nuclear club to send a message to the world of Islam. After Zionists got rid of Faisal and got rid of Bhutto, the OIC returned to what it was, a baby in the arms of the Zionists. And so it is not to the OIC that we can turn for any kind of hope for the world of Islam. No. We have to make a distinction between those who remain within the Zionist embrace, and that is what you are if you are a member of the International Monetary Fund. Only one leader in the Muslim world and the courage, the foresight, the wisdom to take his country out of the IMF. Who is that? Who Who is that? Yes, Sukarno of Indonesia. Took Indonesia out of the IMF, took Indonesia out of the World Bank, took Indonesia out of the United Nations, and as a consequence paid the price with the 9/11, about which Dr. Chandra Muzaffar said to me that he had written on the subject. And they got a Pervez Musharraf in Indonesia by the name of Soeharto to take over and to bring Indonesia back into their arms. The future of the world of Islam is not in the hands of governments which are comfortable with the UN and the IMF and the World Bank. The future of the world of Islam depends upon the emergence of Islamic scholarship with the knowledge and the courage to be able to offer the guidance that Muslims need to be able to take charge of their affairs. Unfortunately, not only has the world of Islamic scholarship failed, but failed miserably. And we have to pray that a future day may come when from our midst may arise that caliber of Islamic scholarship and that courage with which to be able to not only explain the world in which we live today, but guide our people how to respond to it.